Hi, it's Larry Herb, Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Welcome to the show. We're here. There he is.
Hey, you feel better now?
I mean, it's no sophisticated set with animals and, you know, Gary's animal talking thing. By the way, I'm going to work on getting Gary on either next week or the week after. Gary Whitta, I'm talking about his show Animal Talking.
The tables have turned. Yeah. So just this week, I don't know if you saw what you're referring to, is Phil Spencer was a guest on Animal Talking along with Lisa Loeb. And I don't know if you remember the Sweet Life of Zach and Cody, Zach, AKA Dylan Sprouse. I also remember him from, he was in, I think it was Big Daddy, which was a Adam Sandler vehicle, I think you would have said.
As they say in Hollywood, it's an Adam Sandler vehicle. So that's very Hollywood of you.
I try. Yeah, that was right after Happy Gilmore, which, you know, I was at the right age for Happy Gilmore when that came out.
Right. Well, I'm just looking. I was just signing into my console here, as you can see. We both have Hyperscape in the back. Hey, we're going to talk about that in a minute. But in the green room, as we say in the entertainment biz, we have a very special guest, and through the wonders of modern television switching, I'm going to bring him in here. Jeff, do you know who we have with us today? Ladies and gentlemen, can we part the curtain for Mr. Chris Charla, ladies and gentlemen? Chris, good to see you.
Hey, thanks. Yeah, thanks for having me. And now, Jeff, we're neighbors who haven't seen each other in months.
Well, yeah, there was a couple times I know we've gotten a drink, you know, out at the former Chinese restaurant bar that used to be around, but it's been too long. Yep. Granted, I don't really see anyone anymore. So
this is the only way I really get to, you know, we have meetings during the day, of course, on Teams, but Jeff and I, this is our really some of our only social time, but Chris, it's great to see. We want to have you on the show because the program that you run, ID at Xbox, hit a major milestone this week. And we're going to talk about that later in the show. You got a lot of really cool stuff to talk about. So I wanted to get you on, but it's great to see you anyway. I haven't seen you in months. Right.
I know. It's good to see you. It's good to be you. I feel like I'm back in the office almost.
Yeah, it's a bizarre way of working, but we're making the transition. We transitioned the podcast. I've had you on the show in the past when it's been just audio. Now I've got audio and video. I remember when I was sending you email, I'm like, hey, Chris, can you come on the show? I was very clear. Video. I think I had to mention video like three times because everyone thinks, is this video? Yeah, it's video, but it's great to see you. We start off the show by what we're playing, and with all due respect, I'm not going to ask you right now, Chris, what are you playing?
I'm not the guest.
What are you playing today?
So I've been playing some Swim Sanity because it's a kind of a milestone game. And, the other game I've been playing a lot, it came out a couple months ago. Well, I've been playing Dunk Lords, but then, Yes, Your Grace, which is a game, from, No More Robots, publishing. And it's a really intense. It's a strategy game where all you're doing is making choices about what to do, but you have to make some horrible choices. And so it really makes you think, and I don't know if it's the best game to be playing in 2020 or not, but it's a really intense, compelling experience.
I was gonna say, that sounds like real life. All I do is make decisions and immediately regret them.
I don't know if I need another life simulator. Everything's a simulator nowadays. Has anybody come out with the pandemic simulator yet, Chris? Have you seen? I know you see games that are.
There's a game called Pandemic.
I know there's a game called Pandemic. But I didn't know if there was like one based on. I mean, what's in a game and what we're experiencing? Are they all that different? I don't know. But anyway, that's good to hear. Jeff, what are you playing? I mean, we're playing. You and I are playing something. A couple of similar things. I want to go full screen on you because you have one of the games we're playing in the background there, which is
Hyperscape. So Hyperscape. Right over here, this is. We're big Apex Legends fans. We're big Battle Royale fans, I think, in general. I've certainly put in my hours in Fortnite and Call of Duty Warzone. And so Hyperscape just came out this week. It's a free-to-play Battle Royale from our good friends at Ubisoft. And so we've been checking it out. It's very fast-paced. It's very some really interesting visual design. Yeah. Instead of like a ring coming in, which we've seen since PUBG, instead parts of the city start to dissolve and you see them start to pixelate. I think that what they've done is the best story behind it. Exactly. Everyone in the game, it actually takes place in sort of a Ready Player One-esque near future where everyone is just spending most of their time in virtual reality. And what do? You're competing. And so that's a game within a game. And so you see parts of the city start to pixelate, and I think they're voxels, maybe. Where did the triangular voxels? I remember that was a big trend there for a little bit. And they start to disappear, and then all the buildings gone. You don't want to be caught out there at that point, because then you're sniper fodder. So we're still getting a feel for it, but it is very fast-paced.
Now, Chris, do you play Battle Royales? I mean, I know you play all sorts of games. I didn't know. Do you play Battle Royales?
I do, yeah. I play, honestly, I'm a big PUBG guy still.
Oh, okay. The original.
Yeah, and it's, I love it, and it's just, it is a very tense game.
Yeah, I mean, we played PUBG, I still play it a little bit, but that game is such a different style from any of the others. Sure, it's all, you know, the number one always wins, you know, kill or be killed, but the pace and the intensity of PUBG, because those matches can go 30, 40, 50 minutes, is so much slower versus some of the other ones that are out there. So there's, I love the fact that we've got, you know, games that are a little bit more slower and tactical like PUBG, and then we got things that are, you know, faster like Fortnite, and then we go up to, you know, to something like Apex, and then right over to this one. So there's a lot of different ones. So that's good to hear.
Yeah, this sounds awesome. I really want to try it out. But yeah, I still am one of those people who spends most of the time in PUBG hiding in a closet and then just waiting to the end and just being tense. It's just kind of what I like about it. Like, and I don't play teams as always. Oh, just really? One-on-one, you know, and yeah.
Do you have a place you like to drop? Do you go school? Do you go hospital? What's your?
I actually go for river. And my dream in PUBG is like, get a good weapon.
Yep.
Get in a boat, get under a bridge, and just hang out.
Wait.
Yeah.
Okay. So the headline here is Chris Charla is a camper. That's it.
Yeah. That's pretty much.
I should put a fishing mini game in there for you, you know, just to give you something to do.
Awesome. I would happily play like a PUBG, just like fishing mode where all the stuff is happening. But your goal is just to fish. Like, you're in like a fishing competition, and all those other things are happening.
Yeah, it's kind of like those crazy.
Whoever's the last to survive. Yeah, go on.
It's like those crazy photos you see of during, you know, the wars and World War One, where there's this moment of solitude that someone's doing. They're fixing something or helping someone when chaos reigns all around them. Right. That's what we need.
Okay, we need to talk to PUBG about this. Like, getting just like a. Like a 10-person or 20-person like battle royale fishing game happening in the middle of the map, like while everything else is going on, just totally orthogonal goals. I think would be
battle royale fishing game.
If there was one like largemouth bass, and if you caught that, you know, you win. You
Instant
know, why
win.
Does it always have to be the last one standing? Actually, Hyperscape has an alternative. It's not just you can win without. You know, firing a shot if you get the crown first, which shows up late in the game. So I think I like the idea of like, even if it was just a mode.
Right.
I think there's something to it. Fun.
So that's, we're playing that. We played a little bit of Apex. What else am I playing up here? I got to take a look at
Flight Simulator, Larry.
Flight Simulator. I fired up Hexic. You can see Hexic back here.
Oh, wow.
Which
is great.
For those of you that don't know, Hexic is, well, Chris, you know, it was designed by Alexei, who was the original designer of Tetris. And it is also is the claim to fame that is what the very first game that a lot of people got their first achievement on, because for Xbox 360, it shipped, quote unquote, in the box, right? So on the hard drive, so you could play the game. So I was getting back into Hexic for some reason. And of course, with Back and Pat, it looks great.
It's classic.
Yeah,
that's awesome. Yeah, all the early XBLA stuff is fun. I was just, because everything's going on, I had my 360 on, I was playing XBLA, and it was it's a trip to see the 360 dashboard again. It's just like a total trip down memory lane. And obviously we can play all these games on Xbox One with back compat, but playing them on my, you know, R2-D2 360 was like was a super fun experience.
Yeah, that, I mean, everybody always wants, oh, bring the blades back. You know, they were, don't get me wrong, I loved them, that we worked a lot on that team, but I just that was a moment in time. The other game that I'm playing, Chris, I don't know if you've seen this, it's from Lozenge Lab, it's called Swim Out. I talked about it last week. Have you played this?
I haven't played it yet. No.
It is, and it's kind of cool because you dive into a pool and it's a puzzle game. You're like in a pool and you have to swim around other swimmers. And the art style of this game and the music, and of course the puzzles. I just adore this game. I mean, I'm just having a blast with that. It's just so relaxing to kind of swim around, and then you hear the lifeguard whistle when you made a mistake. So I just love Swim Out. So that's a lot of fun.
That's cool. Yeah, and now I know what you're trying to. It's really stylized art style. It's really, really cool.
Yeah, it's is this in Game Pass? I can't remember. I think I mentioned it last week. I don't think so. But
you mentioned it now 3 weeks in a row. We know you're a fan of this game.
Well, I love swimming. So I'm a, as you know, so I adore it. So that's one of the things I'm playing. But yeah, Jeff, you talked a little bit. Flight Simulator, which is out. Is it out now? I'm trying to remember when we're recording.
It comes out on the 18th. So next week. And next week. What you're going to start to see is over the weekend. Over this weekend, you're going to start to see some of like the big simmers, the big creators who are big in Flight Simulator starting to stream it live, drop VODs on YouTube, and they can go wherever they want. So it's going to start to really, I think, get you, warmed up. You're going to start taxiing towards the runway in your mind and start thinking about where you want to go. And I've been seeing a lot of the footage, and it just looks beautiful. So I've downloaded it. I believe you'll be able to start. By the time you hear this, you should be able to pre-download it.
And that's in Game Pass.
Pre-ordered it. Yeah. If you have Xbox Game Pass, you can pre-download and get ready. And then you're going to be able to take off coming Tuesday, which is just going to be phenomenal. So excited for this.
I played a little bit over the past few days, and it's, I was in an Icon aircraft. I flew over your house, kind of your neighborhood, where you and Jeff live, and flew over to my neck of the woods. And it's just a beautiful game. And there's something relaxing about just kind of flying. You're hearing the tower chatter. You're watching this, and you can choose real time. There's so many ways to configure from the plane to what airport, what's your destination. I mean, the world is your oyster. It's unbelievable what you can do in this. So you need to check it out. I don't know if you guys ever played Flight Sim. I assume you did, like I did when you were younger and you played it on. I used to go up. A friend of mine, we didn't have a computer growing up, and a friend of mine, his dad was an engineer for Sikorsky. They make helicopters.
Oh, nice.
When I was growing up in Connecticut, and they had one of the first IBM PCs in the neighborhood with the green 80-column screen, and we would go up there and watch the Sears Tower go by and the horizon. It was amazing. So that was now it looks unbelievable. Hopefully you're going to play, Chris.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, to me, that's one of the games I've been looking forward to the most. I mean, I keep talking about all these stressful games I'm playing. Like, I need something where I just chill out and relax. And I want to just play. I don't want to go in a fast plane. I want to go in a slow plane and just chill out and look at things. I was a geography major, and I'm one of these people. I was just on a flight recently, like during quarantine time. And I'm flying over northern Michigan. I'm looking down. I see like a river and open up maps, and I'm like figuring out where I am. Like, I love that stuff. So just like being able to like fly over things and know where I am is like, it's just kind of like fun for me.
Well, you and I share a passion.
Totally hear you there.
I love maps as well. And I've always talked about how I had maps on my wall when I was growing up. So I'm right with you. I'll tell you this though about Flight Simulator that a lot of people don't know. Is I bet, and let me go to Chris full screen. I bet it was available on that little machine behind you, that little beige box.
Yeah, definitely. That's my Apple II. This has been my kind of my COVID hobby. And definitely. The first place I played Flight Sim was absolutely on the Apple II.
Which was, I believe it was MicroProse at that time, right? I can't remember. I'm pretty sure it's something like that. Or Sublogic.
I think it was. I'm such a. Like,
go to
I want to say it was Sublogic, but I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah. But anyway, so that's wait a minute. Can you turn around and you've got a joystick too.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Now I have the Apple branded joystick and everything. Like, yeah, it's
Apple,
I mean, this
Apple
is
once did things in games, gaming.
That was the first computer I ever used. Back, I learned how to code BASIC on that.
You did 10 print Jeffrey Rubenstein, 20 go to 10.
You would move the little turtles. We would use logo and you would move the turtles around. Nice. And then when, Apple II GS, which was like a world better. I first ever played Tetris on. You could actually like make crude animation. And I remember you would have these little things. They were called turtles, and you could animate them and create sprites.
So a lot
and
of people
I,
don't
and
know
I made
this.
An interactive baseball game.
When you were young, how old was this, Jeff? When you were doing this?
I must have been like 10.
So at 10 years old, you're coding logo to animate teabagging. That's impressive.
I did. Now I'm thinking about it. I made a choose your own adventure. I was like a lot of kids that age, I loved Bo Jackson because he was just like the most famous athlete. Not that I'd ever been to Kansas City or Oakland at the time. And
you
had to choose whether or not he would swing or take the pitch. And I made it because I was, you know, trying to galaxy brain this as a kid. So I figured everyone's going to pick swing. And I actually made it be a wild pitch. If you swung, then, you know, he was mad at you and then he would like fight you. And actually, like, it was almost like a crude Mortal Kombat.
I want to play this game. Bo Jackson.
But if you took the pitch, it was a wild pitch no matter what.
Right.
Then somebody, Kevin Mitchell, came around to score like the 86 Mets or something. And then you won. And then I forget. And then like there was like fireworks and like
I don't know.
Yeah, that was.
Wow. We need more choose your own adventure baseball games in the world.
Isn't baseball really just a choose your own adventure? Like 90% of it's up here.
Well, wait a minute. Jeff, you've got this idea. You've done this. Chris, you've got the hardware. Gentlemen, I have to get you together.
We can do this.
I can read it.
Jeff, I will code you up a little choose your own adventure, Bo Jackson, and then maybe you can even have intermissions where you choose who you're going to be sponsored by, whether it's Nike or whoever.
Who would it have been back in the day? But anyway,
Fila or something.
That's a great machine you got there. Anyway, but thank you for joining us, Chris. And the reason that we got you here, otherwise, you know, in addition to you being a friend of the show, and we're always a big fan of what you're doing with ID at Xbox, is ID at Xbox, you guys had some big announcements this week, and I wanted to talk about that and really have you come on the show and deliver the news yourself. So tell us the headlines.
Yeah, so the biggest news is we just shipped we helped independent developers ship the 2000th game that's come through the ID at Xbox program. So since we started and the first game shipped in 2014 from an independent developer on Xbox One,
right,
2000 games have now shipped. And we also announced, you know, we don't talk about money that often, but we announced that we had paid out more than $1.5 billion in royalties to independent developers over that time. Which to me is just like a great milestone because it just shows how successful developers have been on Xbox. I mean, obviously video games are a hit-driven business. Not every game is a giant success, but developers have had life-changing amounts of success on the platform. And I think for us as players, like we've gotten to play like a ridiculous number of just really amazing games in every genre imaginable. Like I was, you know, talking about it, it's like we've got like Black Desert, is an amazing MMO, like Warframe, which is this super cool, you know, PvE action game, Human Fall Flat, action puzzler, Celeste, you know, like a platform that does totally new things. And the only thing these games have really in common is just how different they are and how much they just really do reflect like the creative vision of a really small group of people. And to me, that's like, it's just really, really cool. And it's cool for me and for the ID at Xbox team. It's obviously not just me. I just am the face they push forward to have gotten to do that and been a small part in helping bring like all these games to Xbox. And as fans and as players, like we just love getting to see them and getting to play them.
Yeah, there's a great blog post that you have over on Xbox Wire, and we can link to that. But I was looking at this graphic, and it's amazing because, you know, 2013-14 you launched, you hit 1,000. It looks like mid 2018, and then it took you a year and a half to reach 2,000. So that's tremendous in terms of the progress there, right?
Yeah, I mean, developers are just they've gone wild and we're seeing more and more cool games. I think when we think back and the blog post kind of takes a historical look and goes, well, it starts all the way back with the Apple II, but then it really talks about Xbox Live Arcade. It's kind of the dawn of when indies broke into the cultural consciousness and kind of like a mainstream way in console gaming. And, you know, and that is a long time ago now. That was like 10, 12 years ago, Castle Crashers shipped. But those games still feel, I mean, if you just like load, sorry, I'm pointing at my Xbox. If you just load Castle Crashers today, like it still feels super fresh. It's still super fun.
Well, this is actually a funny point because whenever, and I know you've been to, and we haven't been in the past 6 months, but whenever we go to PAX or any of these other, you know, big events, Castle Crashers is always there, but they still have it. The behemoth still has it and people are still lining up to play it. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, it's amazing. And it's just cool to see that, like, you know, I kind of made the point in the blog that, like, for, we're now starting to see the first developers come up, young developers doing, you know, typically their first game. And for them, like games like Castle Crashers and Limbo and Super Meat Boy, Braid, like those are history. You know what I mean? Like those are games that maybe like, they actually didn't play when they came out because they were too young. And it's so cool. I remember, obviously, when those games came out, you know, I was making games back then. And I remember thinking, like, and really feeling this with that Summer of Arcade, like, we're entering a golden age of indie. And I remember talking to a friend and being like, well, dude, this is a golden age. We need to be making these games. And then, you know, and having the conversation, like, well, when's it going to stop? Like this, you know, how long is this party going to last? And what happened was that instead of the party stopping or the golden age ending, like the whole industry changed. And these games are now just a crucial part of the mix. Like you can't, in the same way you can't imagine Xbox without Halo or Call of Duty or Madden, you can't imagine Xbox without Inside or Limbo or Castle Crashers and or Cuphead. Right. And so it's just been amazing to see how the, this kind of what at the time we thought might be just this golden season turn into like a completely industry changing paradigm shift and to still be part of it and to see so many cool people be part of it from the developer side and the platform side is just, it's just ridiculous. It's amazing.
When you look at the games that I'm sorry, Jeff, but when you look at the games that have come out, what are some of the themes that you've seen kind of over the past just few years and how things have changed from when we first, you first started the program?
So I think the biggest thing we've seen is just, we're now seeing games at all sorts of different levels of, I'll say scale is maybe the right word to use. Cause I was going to say polish, but that's not right. Cause we see really polished games at all levels, but we see games that come from, you know, single creators, you know, one man, one woman, you know, games like Celeste where it's a really, really small team. And then we see games that are coming from 4-person teams, 12-person teams, 50-person teams that are still, you know, truly like indie games with, you know, complete creative freedom. And that creates like a sense of diversity in the types of games that is really, really cool to see. The other thing that we've seen recently, which I think is really, really fascinating, is we're getting into these second, third, fourth, fifth, independent games. We're starting to see like regional scenes develop where, you know, Seattle games starting to have a Seattle flavor. And games from Melbourne, I always use Melbourne as an example because I think they have a really great style. If you see a bunch of different games that are all made in Melbourne and nobody tells you that, you might not think that won't occur to you. But if I tell you, like, this game was made in Melbourne and this game was made in Melbourne and this game was made in Melbourne, you're like, oh, that is exactly right. And there's just something about those games
that is, like, really reflective of the original scene. That's really interesting. Can you give us an example, whether it's Melbourne or Boston or Orlando or Seattle? What are some of those themes you see, if you could?
So I think with Melbourne, there's just something about the color palettes that they choose, and it's hard to say exactly why, but yeah, there's just something about the games that just like have some good it's hard to put your finger on, but when you see it, you know it. And
all right, Jeff, I'm sorry, you had a question there.
Sure. One of the things I think is really interesting is how the I don't know if it's the definition, but so much as the sort of perception of what an indie game can be has changed, where maybe at the beginning of this generation, a lot of the stuff you cited from the 360 era, maybe were kind of like pixel art, 16-bit or, you know, sometimes 32-bit, but like kind of like they had like a look and you would look at it and go, oh, that's what an indie game is, Super Meat Boy or, you know, just something like that. And then we still see some of that today, even Carrion, which just came out recently. Granted, it's running at like 60 frames a second. It is super smooth and never could have done that on like a Sega Genesis or something, but it kind of has that throwback. But now you see games that are full motion video, or you mentioned, like Tenocon, Warframe, like that look like stunning. And so indie game doesn't necessarily mean a small game, doesn't mean a small team, like you said, but it also doesn't mean a small scope or a small, visual budget anymore either.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And that's been one of the really interesting things. There was this period where, and sometimes we use this term derisively, where there was this kind of like indie as a genre, like indie was a genre. And yeah. Now we've kind of expanded past that. There's still games that, you just mentioned, like Carrion, that just like are pixel art games that just like kill it and are amazing. But now you've got like Ooblets, which is, full 3D game with this incredibly cool dancing combat mechanic and monster growing. You've got Black Desert, which is this, full 3D amazing MMO. Even PUBG is an example of a game that actually started in the ID at Xbox program as a single vision of a single person working with a team. And, I personally always define indie, sometimes people ask, like, is creative freedom. If you've got creative freedom, you're independent. And, PUBG Corp and Bluehole certainly had creative freedom. That was an indie game that went on to not just realize incredible success, but spawn a whole like world-changing genre. So yeah, it's been really cool to see how indies have, I'll say, taken over, and I don't mean it in a mean way. And certainly games from big publishers are still amazing and everything like that. But it's been cool to see how every single, kind of like walk of development, there's now like indie entrants there.
I actually think it's more, you talked about them, I think it's more just the maturing of the market and the maturing of what the games are. It's also ties into, the tools, the fact that your team works on these great tools, because developers can have these great ideas, but they don't have the right tools in the development kit, then they're, it's going to be a real big uphill battle. But your team actually does a lot of work to build tools to make it easy so that they can rev quicker and get stuff posted and look at it and test it and refine and refine and refine. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And obviously, this is not something we do in a vacuum. We're working with all sorts of teams at Microsoft. But what we kind of bring is the voice of the developer and saying, like, hey, how can we make this a little bit easier for these guys? How can we, if we can shave a day off the game development process that's only spent working on Xbox stuff, that's a day they can spend, making the game better or more polished. Right. And you think about when we partner with, folks like Unreal or GameMaker, Game Engines, to get those things on Xbox and make sure that it's easy for developers to use. Our North Star is always just like, let's just make it as easy as possible for developers. Like, let's make sure that we at Microsoft are doing the hard work so it's easy for devs. That's just going to result in amazing games. I've had people ask me, what does a typical day look like? And obviously talking to developers is part of that, and it's like the fun part. But talking internally about just like, how can we improve processes? How can we do things better? And, we've made huge leaps and bounds in the last 7 years, and we've got like huge leaps and bounds to go. So it's never boring. There's always more we can do. And as we bring in things like the power of Xbox Series X, how do we make it easier for developers to take advantage of that power? How do we make sure we're getting dev kits out in the field as fast as possible and everything like that? So it's never a dull moment.
Well, in that case, so I'm going to go back on something I said. I don't want the Bo Jackson simulator on that beige box. I want it on the Xbox. Jeffrey, I need you to work with Chris.
We can do it now. I just need the tools. So really, this is on you, Chris. I think if you just get me those and I can code it up in logo.
All right. We'll get something going in either Unreal or possibly Game Maker and get the Bo Jackson choose your own adventure hitting game going.
I think the
market is crying out for it.
Well, they're certainly after they hear this show, they will. So I actually want to point out, because you mentioned Swim Sanity at the top of the show. According to this blog post, does that have the distinction of being the 2000th game? So hooray!
Yeah, that was 2000. And it couldn't, it's a great, it's a two brother team, you know, is led by two brothers. And they're just such, such cool people. And they had joined the program. And then Sarah Condy, who's on the ID team, met them at the Game Devs of Color Expo and got to know them. And we brought the game to PAX. I think, Larry, you got to meet them when they were at PAX 1 year. And yep. Then they've just gone from like a, you know, sort of success to success. It's a local multiplayer game, so it's super fun to like get friends together and play. And it's just a really cool one.
I also want to point out that I was reading your blog post, obviously, when you posted it. And the one thing that really rang through to me was the games in the Ziploc bags. I mean, that was such a thing for me when I would go to my local computer store, it was 20 miles away in Connecticut. And I would go there, and I remember we'd go in the back, and it was exactly that. It was all this wall of Ziploc bags, and you'd pull them down, and you'd open it up, and sometimes there was a manual, sometimes there wasn't. And it was, and you know, of course, it was even more complicated then, because did you have the right disk drive? Was it a double density disk drive to run, or was it a single density, right? You know, it was all those other things, and so you had to make sure you had the right hardware at home to run it. But that was such a special time for me, not only to go to the computer store and have that experience, but also to meet other people, because that was really, you know, that was the moment. Those were the original message boards, was that computer store. And Chris, I'm sure you probably had that same experience.
Oh, absolutely. That feeling of going to the store, computer stores, back when people went to stores, and just like, You typically didn't happen to know a lot. Even if you got the computer magazines, there was so much there that wasn't there. Yeah. And a lot of these games were made by indie creators who duplicated them at their home disk drives and then just dropped them in a Ziploc with like a mimeographed maybe right. manual.
With handwritten notes in the margin.
Yeah, handwritten notes. And I was just playing the first game I ever got for the Apple II a couple days ago. I found it again. And,
which is?
I had to hold the label off it because I knew that it had just like a regular like store label underneath, and I wanted to see it.
What was the name of the game? What was the name of the game?
It's called like Sumar, and it's it's one of these like ancient Sumerian civilization simulators. It's pretty cool.
It was a genre.
Sumerians
itself,
had very
was it?
Interesting computers. Yeah,
But you know what's cool to me, and I've made this point to a couple people, and they kind of got it. And Larry, I think you will too. When I think about Game Pass like takes me back to that because when you have like Xbox Game Pass, all of a sudden you have access to like hundreds of games on PC and on console, and you are going to find, you know, we always say you'll find your next favorite game, and absolutely you're going to find your next favorite game. You're also going to find a bunch of weird stuff. You're going to find a bunch of games that you never would have downloaded otherwise.
Yep.
And for me, I go back like you to that old computer store, like going the 20 miles to the Apple II store and looking around. I think for Jeff, your generation, like people a little bit younger, it's about going to Blockbuster and finding the NES game to rent for the weekend. And that is a special moment. And I feel like Game Pass brings that kind of novelty back, where you're just like hunting around and you know you're going to find something cool.
Well, not only that, but not only with Game Pass, to your point, I completely agree with you, Chris, is you know, it's kind of like you own the store. You can play anything you want. You don't have to buy it. And that's the beautiful part. It's funny. I was sitting here as you said that about the computer store. I think there was this, and Jeff, you're a little too young for this, but I don't know about you, Chris, but all the computer stores I remember growing up, they always had the name Byte in it somehow, right? It was always something Byte something, Last Byte.
Yeah, Byte Shop.
Right. It was always something like that. But I just, that was Meriden, Connecticut. That's where it was. That's where mine was, in Meriden. So anyway, it's interesting you say that about Game Pass, because that's exactly what that feeling is that you can just go experiment, go try something, you know? Although I do kind of want to have a mimeograph manual every now and then. Games are seriously lacking in manuals. I think we can all agree on that.
I would love that. I would love a game that let you send in like a self-addressed stamped envelope to get a manual or something like that.
That was always the best thing to do, because when you're, and again, this, Jeff, this is two old guys going back, but you go home and while you're waiting for this to copy to your hard drive, at least you had something to read, right? You're like getting ready to read. And
the manual is what you read while your mom was driving you home from right. the electronics boutique, right. which right. Was my version of that, or software, et cetera. Yeah, you would read the book, and then by the time you got home, it was like, okay, I finished
you knew what
it.
To do.
Now right. I'm really ready. Yeah,
right.
I remember bringing bringing the manual into school one day when I got Zelda. I managed to get Zelda before everyone else because Hanukkah came before Christmas that year, and score one for Hanukkah. And so I got Zelda before a lot of my friends did. Just bringing that in, I was popular for a couple of days.
You were the
and
it
then,
kid.
And then Christmas. I was.
The thing I miss most about manuals is you'd get to the back and there'd be that notes page, like you're supposed to take notes there, but really they just didn't have enough content. And someday I want to work on a game again that has a notes page at the back of the manual.
Well, and then of course, the other thing was I think they were called physicals or physiables. What was that stuff that Infocom used to put in the games? You know, all those puzzles and the DRM stuff where essentially in the game, it would say, well, what's on page 27 of, you know, the witness guide, right? Yeah, right. Exactly. Yeah,
so, if you happen to have the Wishbringer, which literally we didn't talk about this beforehand, but I have it next to me because I've been playing it. So your games have come with like things like a glow in the dark stone or like a special letter.
Stuff that made sense in the lore of the game, in the story. And then in the story themselves, as you were progressing, Jeff, this was the DRM. You'd have that would like randomly
if you didn't
pop
have
up.
It, you couldn't get past it.
Yeah, it would say, "What's this?"
And
you'd be like,
"You
didn't know."
To look it up on.
So you'd have to flip to the page. those are the days. Anyway, I didn't even realize you had.
I got
that,
a question
Chris.
For you. Let's bring it back into now, just because I want to ask. The summer is when we tend to see a ton of indie games hit. It's also the opportunity when there's maybe fewer sort of AAA big budget, you know, annualized titles. They're not out yet. So I'm curious. I was looking ahead on the calendar. There's just a lot of games dropping over the next few weeks. Is there anything that's caught your eye? Anything we should keep our eye out for, Chris?
There are a ton of cool games coming. I don't want to single anybody out. I'm gonna dodge that question gently, but I am gonna say I've been playing I haven't played it yet, but Heroes of Hammerwatch, which is kind of like a roguelite, I think is really cool, and I'm kind of stoked about that one. But I'll also give a couple shout outs to It Lurks Below and Undermine, and then but also Swim Sanity. Like, I think the guys at Decoy did a really nice job with that, and people should check it out. I'm bummed that we don't have PAX this year, because they always had, for Swim Sanity, you could get like this sort of foam shark helmet,
right?
You know, for playing the game. And I'm bummed we can't do that this year.
Well, not only am I bummed that we're not having PAX, but we always invited people onto campus, and your team did the ID at Xbox reception where people could come out to campus and we'd set up 30, 40, 50, 60 different places for people to play games. So yeah, it's a drag, but here we are.
Yeah. Next year.
But we just came off this interesting demo fest that was just a few weeks ago with all the demos. Did that go well? For those that don't know, Chris, tell us about the demo fest.
Yeah, so that was something really cool. So it's kind of part of Summer Game Fest. We invited developers to share demos with the world. And so we had them available for a week. And these were games that were in progress. They weren't like finished games. And so people kind of got to experience what it's like to be at E3 or be at PAX and play like the short pre-release games. And it was really, really popular. I think it was like the most likes I ever got on a post when we talked about it. And it was cool to be able to share that with everybody. And before I was at Microsoft did it way back in the past with like Lost Planet Extreme Condition.
Yep.
They released the E3 demo. But it hasn't happened in a long time. And so it was really cool to have people check it out. It was really popular, and we've gotten a lot of requests to do it again. So maybe we will. I thought it was really neat. It was cool for devs to get that feedback from players, and it was cool for players and fans just to get to check out a bunch of games.
And we know a lot of people are at home right now, and they're playing games, and so why not check out stuff that's in progress? So that's great to hear.
Kind of replicated that GDC experience that we typically have an indie show. And it's something that I feel like privileged to be able to experience by attending GDC. And I felt like we brought that home for the first time. I love that.
Yeah, absolutely. When GDC got postponed, you know, we released a bunch of videos of the games that we were going to have playable, but now we can let people actually play the games. I think it's just a really nice, it's a nice thing to do. So we're definitely looking to do more of it.
We've we're kind of cruising along here. Jeff, do you have some news you want to go over here? I mean, we've got a lot of news. Chris, you're welcome to stay with us. We're going to talk about some news. I don't know what your schedule is.
Yep. But I will hang out and listen.
Awesome. Jeff.
Cool. Well, we'll be brief here.
You've got some headlines.
I think that, a lot of you probably saw that we have confirmed that the Xbox Series X is coming out in November. That was something that came out earlier this week, and Phil was on Animal talking about that a little bit more, and also that Halo Infinite will be coming out in 2021. So you can check out Xbox Wire and also Halo Twitter for more on that.
Yep.
You know what's getting a lot of buzz, and I think this would be very much up your alley, Chris, is Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 1 and 2. It's getting remastered, remade, and I'm hearing a lot of great things. If you pre-order it, you can access this demo that lets you skate around Alcatraz right now. So I feel like this works on, you know, for you on a lot of levels. I know you're a skater, see at the skate park in the neighborhood. Also, Bay Area guy, and probably, maybe I'm a leap of logic here, maybe a Tony Hawk fan?
I am a Tony Hawk fan, both of the real guy and of the pro skater game. Way back in the day when I was a journalist, I got to interview Tony Hawk when I worked at the Dreamcast magazine. And we set up at his like home ramp in Carlsbad, and we ended up trying to interview him while he did a 540 over our heads, or was like sort of sitting on the lip of the ramp. It was really kind of a fun thing. I pre-ordered, but I didn't pre-order digitally, so I can't play that level. But I should be getting a skateboard is my pre-order bonus. I did the deluxe edition, and so it's going to come with a birdhouse skateboard. So I'm like, so ready for this. I'm super, super stoked about it.
A demo is temporary. The skateboard lasts forever.
Yeah.
That's right.
In fact, I had Tony on a few months ago when they announced the game was coming. So you can scroll back on the podcast and take a look. It's one of the very first video interviews we did, right, Jeff?
Good friend of the show.
Good friend of the show. That's right.
So Minecraft Dungeons is a game I can't get enough of. The first DLC pack, the Jungle Pack, that released last month. Well, we now have a date on the next one, which is coming out September 8th, which sounds like it's far away, but in the world we're in, it's actually a couple weeks away. And so that will be the Creeping Winter DLC. These DLC maps have been just phenomenal, like really big, meaty maps with a lot to do. But what's really important is a free game update is coming that's going to add a lot to the core gameplay. So even if you're not interested in the DLC, there's going to be new merchants, daily trials, you'll be able to rescue merchants and bring them back to your village. So definitely looking forward to what that's going to enable you to do. And just a couple of things for the weekend. One is Injustice 2 and NASCAR Heat 5. They are free to play. They are free for Xbox Live Gold and Xbox Game Pass Ultimate members. Justice 2, quite an excellent game. So
I think Xbox is sponsoring one of the cars, Jeff, in the NASCAR. I know you're a NASCAR fan. You're from that area.
I've made a lot of lefts in my day, but let's see. Yeah, JJ Yelly's 27 car.
There it is.
On Sunday's NASCAR in Daytona is going to be. Now I know who I'm rooting for. So sorry, other NASCAR people. We're Team JJ this week.
Yes, we are.
And last but not least, just want to announce for our friends in Brazil that we have announced or that we have released now. Xbox Wire in Portuguese, and that came out last week. You can, if you're over on Xbox Wire, news.xbox.com, you'll see in the upper right corner a little globe. You can click on there. You will see Xbox Wire em Portuguese. My accent is terrible, so if you're in Brazil or in Portugal and would prefer in your preferred language to be able to read it, all the news is going to be there. So it joins the stable of international Xbox Wire teams. I'm glad we were able to finally get that out there for you. Let us know what you think.
I'm sorry, Jeff. I have the window open here in my house, and this plane just went over. We're talking about Flight Simulator, and I have an app on my phone. I can tell what's going over my house. It's the Dreamlifter. Have you ever seen this thing?
Oh, what app is that?
It's an app. Cool. What is it called? It's called Flight Radar 24. So every once in a while, because I live north of Seattle near Boeing Field, and the Dreamlifter is this airplane that delivers parts. It's just, I mean, you saw it. It's huge. Look it up on the internet.
Okay.
So that's what that's what all that racket was over my house. So I highly recommend it.
I thought you were just playing the game in stereo sound, and you know, we're
the big question is, can you fly the Dreamlifter in Flight Simulator? That I need to find out.
Well, with that, I think you should.
So anyway, what else we got there, Jeff? Because otherwise, we're going to wrap things up next week. Our coming weeks, we got a lot of folks coming on. We'll get Gary Witta from Animal Talking in here. I'm going to turn the tables on him. I'm going to put him on the spot. He's always putting people on the spot.
Larry, you should do the interview inside like Minecraft Dungeons or inside, you know, or in Flight Simulator or something like that. You should bring him into a game.
I think that's a grand idea. I think we'll take our suggestions. Hit us up. In fact, if you want to find us on Twitter, I'm going to throw all of our stuff up here now. You can find me at Major Nelson. Chris at IOCAT. Jeff is the complaint desk. At Jeff Rubenstein.
Jeff Rubenstein. Thank you.
There you go. Anyway, all right, gang. We're gonna wrap it up. Wrap it up here. Chris, congratulations to you and the entire team. I know there's a whole team behind you that works on ID at Xbox. On behalf of all Xbox gamers everywhere, thank you, and thank you, your team, for bringing us these amazing games. And I know you've got a lot of stuff in the pipeline, so we're looking forward to seeing what you're going to do with Series X.
Yeah, we have thousands more coming. So thanks to all the developers who helped out, and everybody, you guys, for getting the word out. And obviously the ID at Xbox team are all super rad folks who work tirelessly to help developers get their games out. So thanks to everybody on the team as well.
All right. Well, with that note, go download some great games and Swimsanity, right, Chris? That's the number 2000. So you should all check out Swimsanity.
Yep, that's 2000.
At the very least, and celebrate. And if you want to hit Chris up on Twitter, congratulate him at IOCAT. All right, gang. We'll see you guys next week. Have a great day. Bye-bye, everybody.